Well, welcome back. Happy New Year. I hope you had a really blessed Christmas. I imagine yours was probably like mine, a little bit different, maybe a little more quiet than it usually is. But it was a wonderful time as we celebrated the birth of our Christ. And I am looking forward to 2021, and I'm praying for the Lord to really show up in ways that that we've not seen him do before. And I'm excited to see what he might do. So I hope that you are as well. I pray that you are safe and healthy. And I'm glad to be back with you. So I am the teaching director of the Castle Rock CBS class, and we are continuing our study in the Gospel of John. Before Christmas break, we stopped with John 8. Jesus proclaimed in that chapter that he was the light of the world. And now in chapter 9, he gives light to a blind man. I don't have any divisions for you, because I really want us to enter into this as a story. I really want us to enter into the moment, and the magic of the moment, the supernatural of the moment. And so let's just begin by asking the Lord, who is the giver of light, to open our eyes to see in ways that we're not able to see before. So, Father, I just ask you, may we just get lost in your word. May your word just come alive to us. May it speak to our hearts. May it direct our paths. May it illuminate the things that you have called us to do, the areas in our life that we need to cleanse and clean out, and then those areas that you're saying go forth in. And so, Father, join us now. Father, may the words that are spoken be your words and your words alone, and may you be glorified. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Well, I want you to remember, so during the Feast of Tabernacles, the Jewish Feast of Tabernacles is when Jesus went back into Jerusalem. And during that time, there are four chandelier, giant chandelier-like lampstands. And they are all lit. And when they are alight, you can see the light from them for miles. The blazing light is seen for miles, and it fills all of Jerusalem. And in the midst of this scene, Jesus stands up and he says and proclaims, "I am the light of the world. I am the light of the world, and whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Now, in chapter 9, there is a man who's born blind, and he meets the light of the world. He received the Lord's healing touch, and for the very first time in his life, he is able to see. I mean, actually see with his eyes. And John 9, the lesson in John 9, it is so obvious to us because we are all born spiritually blind, right? But once the Lord comes and introduces himself to us and opens our hearts, and our hearts are open to the light of the world, and we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, then he fills every dark corner of our lives with his light. So have you ever thought of living without sight? How difficult that must be? This man was born blind, and he never saw the beauty of the Mediterranean Sea. He didn't see the light that shone from the temple. He never saw a sunrise, which we have beautiful sunrises and sunsets here in Colorado. He never saw the face of his mother or his father. But in a moment's time, that would all change with a divine encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Now, it's interesting to note that this is the first and only time that there is someone who is born with a congenital affliction is healed. And in Jesus' time, in our time today, people with disabilities are marginalized, and they are tragically often marginalized in society, but also in our churches. And they don't always find a place there. Our second son was born with cerebral palsy, Seth. His name is Seth. And at the age of 5, he was labeled unteachable by our neighborhood school. Now, can you believe anybody at the age of 5 is unteachable? But he was labeled unteachable. And so when when Jesus and his disciples encountered that blind man, the disciples saw this man only as a case study, unteachable, unwanted. But Jesus, he saw this man. I mean, he really saw him. He saw that that man was broken and hurt. He saw that he was discarded by his family and even by the religious community. But deeper than that, he saw the emotional pain and the physical blindness that this man was suffering for, that darkness of spiritual blindness. And he had compassion on him. So let's begin by looking at John 9:1, and we'll just read from the passage for a moment. It says, as he passed by, he saw a man born blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And Jesus answered, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is night or day, because night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. So John presents this story as spontaneous. You know, as they passed by, it seems very random, a mere coincidence. But I want you to make no mistake. There is no randomness in this encounter. It is intentional, and it is a divine encounter. This chance meeting had been scheduled from the beginning of time, before this man had even been a twinkle in his earthly father's eye. The man's seemingly meaningless affliction had been given a divine purpose from the foundation of creation. Now, our son Seth was 18 months old when the neurologist determined that he had cerebral palsy. And his diagnosis said that most likely he would never speak or walk. He wasn't walking at age 18 and he was nonverbal. And so the neurologist just determined that maybe he would never do either one. But as I walked out of that office that day, what came to mind was Psalm 139. It said, I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You knit me together in my mother's womb. And all the days are ordained for me that are written in your book. And written in your book before one of them has come to be. And I just knew in that moment that the Lord was assuring me that this was not a mistake, that Seth was not a mistake, that God was present in the midst of this, and that he would bring glory in the midst of it. So as Jesus was speaking to his disciples, he wanted them to see that God was present in the midst of the suffering. Instead of looking for an explainable source of the man's blindness, he wanted them to see that God would be glorified in the midst of it. I want you to know that there is not always a direct link between suffering and personal sin. There is not. Sometimes we live in a fallen world and life happens. It just happens. The truth was that the blind man was afflicted so that the works of God might be displayed in him. And God wants to do that in all of our lives, all of our lives. He wants to display his glory in all of our lives. Now, F.F. Bruce, he says this, this does not mean that God deliberately caused the child to be born blind in order that after many years, his glory should be displayed in the removal of the blindness. To think so would again be an accusation on the character of God. It does mean that God overruled the disaster, the child's blindness, so that when the child grew to manhood, he might, by recovering his sight, see the glory of God in the face of Christ. And others, seeing this work of God, might turn to the true light of the world. So God has a purpose for all things, and it's to bring him glory, and it's for our best. You know, Exodus 4:11. Is a scene where God is telling Moses that he's being sent. He is to go. And Moses says, oh, no, don't call me, for I can't speak in public. In fact, I stutter. And God says this to him. He says, who gave human beings their mouths? Who makes them deaf or mute? Who gives them sight or makes them blind? Is it not I, the Lord? God takes full responsibility. He is sovereign. And he works out his good and perfect will, even in a world that is sinful and fallen. So from God's perfect and holy perspective, that man's condition, it displays God's work. It gives answers where there are only questions, and yet it still leaves a mystery of faith. You know, after Seth's diagnosis, I wanted to fix him. I wanted to know why. I wanted to know what caused it, and I wanted to know how I could fix it. But I found the answer in the scriptures, and honestly, it wasn't an answer that I expected. But what I found in the scripture is that in the challenges, and in the sorrow, and in the uncertainty, God was there. He was present. I found in God's word that he intercedes for us in prayer. and that we share in this fellowship of suffering with Christ. So in and through this, I knew that God would be glorified. I prayed for healing because I knew that the creator of the heavens and the earth, he could breathe into Seth's brain and all those broken connections could be made whole and restored. And God did answer, but his answer was wait. One word, wait. Wait. Wait for the perfect and complete healing of Seth on the other side of heaven. So I can't fully understand why. I don't have a full answer to why. It's still mystery to me. But what I do know is that Seth has brought incredible joy. In fact, his middle name is Isaac, which means laughter. And he has brought laughter and joy and richness to our life and to the life of others. So in this instant in John 9, this divine encounter with Jesus, it now brought restoration of sight, not on the other side of heaven, but on this side of heaven. And so the disciples asked Jesus in verse 2, says, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Now, before we're too hard on the disciples, we do have to understand that it was a common belief that that a fetus in the womb could sin, and that a kick from that unborn baby was a sign that they were sinning. That's what they believed at that time. They also taught in the Torah that God often visited the iniquity of the father to the third and the fourth generation. And truly, we can see that is the case today with drug and alcohol abuse that causes an unborn child to be born and experience withdrawals and also other complications. But the trouble with the disciples in that moment and in their question, it was that the man's condition didn't move their heart. There was no compassion in them. In fact, what they did is they saw this man as a theological case study. But Jesus saw the man. He saw this man, and this man was not an object lesson. He was broken, he was dejected, and he needed a savior. And then Jesus does something about that man's condition. In verse 6, it says that he spit on the ground, made some mud with saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. He said to the man, go, wash yourself in the pool of Siloam. And this word means sense. Now, there was another time recorded in Mark 7:33 where Jesus healed using saliva. Now, you and I, we often look for formulas, don't we? I want a formula of how God will answer my prayers. So I look in the scriptures. Oh, is there a formula here? If I pray like this, God will always answer my prayers. I want a formula of how God heals. Now, God heals in all kinds of wonderful ways, but he did heal also using saliva in 7:33, and he healed a deaf man. The deaf man was brought to Jesus, and Jesus put his fingers into the man's ears, and then he spit and touched the man's tongue, and the man's ears were opened, and his tongue was loosened. And we wonder why. Why, Jesus, did you choose to spit and make mud? Why didn't Jesus go with him to the pool? You know, rarely, I want you to hear this, because rarely does God ever answer our why questions. What he did do, though, is God gave this man, through the Lord Jesus Christ, specific instructions. And by faith, this man obeyed. The man went, he washed, and he came home seeing. Amazing. Praise God for that. Now, I want us to enter into this experience. So for the first time, this man saw his own hand. He saw the blue and the beauty of the pool, the brilliance of the sun that was shining above. He saw the beauty, and it must have just sent him to his knees. Then he looked up and he looked at the faces and he matched the voices up to the face of his neighbors as they asked him, isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg? Some claimed that he was and some said, no, it just looks like him. They wanted to deny the miracle. But you know what? Not one time does it say that they were amazed and that they rejoiced with him. Not one time does it even say that they couldn't believe their eyes. Because before them stood a miracle. No, instead of leading him to a celebration, they dragged him to an interrogation. And he was made to stand before the Pharisees and give account as if he had done something wrong. So in verse 13, they bring this man to the Pharisees. And now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was the Sabbath. Oh, we know that's going to be trouble, right? In verse 15, it says, "Therefore the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. And the man replied, 'He put mud on my eyes. I washed and now I see.' He applied clay." Instant condemnation from the Pharisees. Their man-made requirements forbid making clay on the Sabbath, much less applying it. They weren't amazed by the miraculous healing, nor did they show compassion for the man who was healed, but instead what they did, they rejected the miracle because Jesus had broken the Sabbath. He hadn't violated the divine Sabbath regulations revealed in scriptures, but because he had ignored their restrictions and their extra-biblical applications, the rabbis immediately found him guilty and a sinner. But remember, this isn't the first time that Jesus deliberately violated their traditional Sabbath regulations. But we find that the Pharisees then say, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." Yet they really didn't believe that this man had been born blind and was now able to see. And so what do? They send for the man's parents that they might question them. Now consider the threat of the Pharisees. Consider how intimidating that must have been. It was intimidating to be brought before them and know that a parent, that oftentimes it was so intimidating that even a parent would turn against a child because there was the threat of excommunication. And the Pharisees stand before the parents and they ask them three questions. The first one, "Is this your son?" And of course they answered, "This is our son." And then, "Was he born blind?" "Well, we know he was born blind," was their answer. And then the third question they ask, "How is it now that he can see?" Now, this is where they cop out and they put it back on their son. And they say, "Well, he's a man, so you ask him." The Pharisees are Pharisees, those who practice legalism, will always use intimidation. But I want you to know that grace is designed to free us. They threaten to excommunicate the man's parents, but God gives us freedom under his grace. So verse 24, a second time they summon the man who had been blind and they say, "Give God glory by telling the truth. We know that this man was a sinner." Now I love the man's response because you are seeing the courage that the Lord Jesus Christ gave him for such a moment. This man had been a beggar for all these years. He'd been dejected by all of society. He'd been a beggar, dependent on the little coins that was given to him on a daily basis. Do you think he had any self-worth? And yet he stands now before the Pharisees, the religious leaders and the authorities, and the courage that the Lord infuses him with to testify to the goodness of God, to give God glory, is amazing. And the man replies, "Whether he's a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know is that I was blind and now I see." Now, I want you to see this because the man is getting irritated with the Pharisees because they continue to question him. And so they ask him again. They say, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" Now, we love his response because he says to them, "I have told you already and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciple too?" Amazing. This former beggar who was rejected by society and the religious community now begins to teach the law keepers. Shocked by the religious leader's inability to see, he points out that God does not do the bidding of unrepentant sinners. God responds to those who worship him. You know, the religious leaders, they knew the scriptures better than anyone else. And they had been trained in the Hebrew history and theology, and yet the man born blind had no difficulty putting the facts together to arrive at the obvious conclusion. Jesus' amazing healing of that blind man, who was blind since birth, it was not even enough to soften the hardened hearts of the Pharisees. And so the Pharisees now had no option. They set aside their facts and they played the trump card. Essentially, they admitted, "You know, we don't have an answer, so we'll excommunicate him." Throughout this dialogue, we see this man's faith growing because at first when he was questioned, he said, a man called Jesus healed me. And then he's questioned more and he says, "Well, the man, Jesus was a prophet." But now, before the Pharisees, this man declares, "If this man was not from God, he could do nothing."
The courage and the boldness he displayed before the Pharisees was given to him by the Lord Jesus Christ, so that he was able to stand up strong even in the face of intimidation and excommunication. You know, I often wonder, you know, because every generation sees the signs of the end times, right? And I often wonder, what would I do in the midst of obvious and intense persecution? And I'm always so afraid that I would not stand firm. But this gives me hope, because Jesus Christ is the one who enables us to stand firm. And so I know that no matter what we face in the days ahead, no matter what happens, God will give us the courage to proclaim his name, even in the face of opposition. So the man he doesn't yet know, so this blind man who has now been healed, who has been given sight by the giver of light, he doesn't yet know Jesus personally. And so he still is spiritually blind. But God, because God doesn't leave him like that. Jesus didn't abandon him, and nor would he leave him in that condition. Jesus sought him out and found him. And that's in verse 35. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" And the man says, "Who is he, sir? Tell me, so that I may believe in him." And Jesus said, "You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." And then the man said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshiped him. For all of his life, this man had been put out of the religious community. You know, the greatest battle in the trenches of church is those who are like the Pharisees, the ones who are self-appointed and self-righteous, who want to push around and deny grace. But I want you to remember this, that grace is designed to set us free. It's found in a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. It is never found in religion or religious activity. Jesus found him. And when you are freed from the bondage of religion, then you're able to find Jesus Christ. And in that, you find the true abiding relationship with your Creator. And the Pharisees now are exposed by the light. The Spirit of God opened this man's heart to the truth. He revealed to him Jesus' true identity. And without hesitation, the man says, "I believe. I believe." And in verse 38, it says that he worshipped him. You know, as the last signs of spiritual darkness was dispelled and the eyes of this man's heart was opened up, he saw clearly who Jesus was, and he responded the only way possible, and that's out of worship, out of worship. You know, I met a woman earlier this week, a very lovely lady who's devoutly religious, and she kindly shared with me a card with a prayer for healing. Now, on that card, at the very bottom of it, in small print, it says to repeat this prayer 3 times for 7 days and then go to confession, and your prayer will be answered. You know, this woman, devoutly religious, lovely lady with a pure heart there, but she was spiritually blind. And she had been blinded by the Pharisees who had taught her works instead of grace. And I pray that she will know the light giver and that she would experience the freedom through his grace. Jesus says now in 39, he says, "For judgment I have come into this world, so that the blind will see and those who see will become blind." And some of the Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, "What? Are we blind too?" And Jesus said, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains." You know, it almost seems as if these words here is in direct contradiction of the words that was spoken in John 3:17, when Jesus said, God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. But I want us to know that far from being contradictory, these two truths actually complement one another. They're the two sides of the same reality. To reject Jesus' peace is to receive his punishment. And to reject his grace is to receive his justice. If we reject his mercy, then we receive his wrath. And if we reject his love, we receive his anger. But if we reject his forgiveness, then we receive his judgment. So while Jesus came not to condemn, Those who reject his gospel condemn themselves, and they are subjecting themselves to judgment. I want you to know that spiritual sight comes only to those who acknowledge that they do not see, who confess their spiritual blindness and their need for the light of the world. And then on the other hand, those who think they see on their own apart from Christ, they are deluding themselves and they will remain blind. Now I want us to stop for a moment. I want us to apply all this because what a day in this man's life. Jesus gave him physical sight, but 1,000 times better than that, Jesus gave him spiritual sight. I want you to know that Jesus opens the eyes of the blind. And I think just like the disciples were, we are all blind in some way. Some of us are totally spiritually blind and we need Jesus. We need salvation. We need the giver of light. But there's others of us where we look at those around us and we don't look with eyes of compassion or a heart of tenderness. We don't want to take them to Jesus. We want to use them as a case study. And Jesus wants to lift that blindness in our lives as well. So won't you allow him to open yours in whatever manner that means? I remember that day as a young teenager when my sight was restored and Jesus Christ found me. And I tell you what, I couldn't get down that aisle to say yes to Jesus quick enough. Not everyone received my transformation well. And I do have to admit, I was really very, very zealous as a youth. And I remember my dad saying to me, you know, Pam, you are not going to argue me into heaven. I am so glad that he is in heaven today. But it didn't take an argument to get him there. But I moved from religion to relationship, and it changed my life. You know, Chuck Swindoll tells a story of a friend who's an ophthalmologist. He said his friend says that there is nothing like the moment in the dark room when the bandages are taken off and the dim lights are raised, and his patient proclaims, "I can see, I can see." But he takes that moment and he says to them, No, you can't see fully yet. Let me introduce you to the one who can give you complete sight. And he has them read the eye chart, but this eye chart doesn't have random letters on it. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." He says, words cannot express the joy he experiences when he introduces not only physical sight, but spiritual sight as well. The truth is that some of us are bandaged. Some of you are bandaged within. You do not see. And you may be like that lovely lady I met this week who has believed the teaching of the Pharisees that religion and good works will earn you a place in heaven. And somehow you believe that by going through the religious motions that God will say to you that you are indeed an exception. Welcome in. But the truth is that all must come to God the same way, and that is through his son, Jesus Christ, the giver of light. And the only way to gain spiritual sight, it is through that giver of light, through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ said to his disciples, "Night is coming." I want us to know that the day of salvation is now. It is today. Night is indeed coming, and it will be too late. So my friends, don't settle for empty religion, because there is grace that is designed to set you free, and free you will be. Jesus opens the eyes of the blind, so won't you allow him to open yours? Let me close with these words from a hymn, and may they echo through your mind this week and become your prayer. It says that, "Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee, ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me, Spirit divine. Open my ears that I might hear voices of truth thou sendest clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Open my mouth and let me bear tidings of mercy everywhere. Open my heart and let me prepare love with thy children thus to share. Open my mind that I might read more of thy love in word and deed. What shall I fear while yet thou dost lead? only from light. From thee I plead. Father, you are the giver of light. Illuminate those dark areas in our life that needs your light to dispel the darkness, to change habits that have no place in our life, to cleanse areas that need to be cleansed. Father, for those precious ones that do not know you, this is the day. Let them find spiritual sight in the light giver, Jesus Christ. I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, blessings to you, my friends. Now come back next week. I will look forward to seeing you. Thank you for joining me today.